Good morning.
Good morning.
So happy to see everybody here today. Looks like we have Ms. Watts, Doug Watts will be our speaker. We have Kathy Enmo in the house. Guest musicians today. And also we have on piano our house musician, Rick. And one bit of housekeeping, if you would please put your phones on silence during the service, we'd appreciate it. Thank you.
What the use is? I don't want to blow everybody away. Is that too loud? Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I am so glad to see you this morning. Oh, everybody's sitting back. And those on the internet, thank you for visiting us this morning. I was thinking before I sat up here, I was thinking, you know, yesterday was yesterday. And, oh, I don't know, the disappointments or the problems that happened yesterday. Well, they were yesterday. It's not today. Today's new possibilities. All right, everything's possible today. Today's a new day. Welcome to Valley Community Church Divine Science. I often talk about the church down the road. And, well, I've got to bring him up again. And there's a small girl. I think she's in the fifth grade. She goes to an elementary school close by. And she goes to Sunday school. And in Sunday school, they've been studying about Jonah and the whale. Well, she was sitting in her classroom with the fifth grade teacher. And the teacher was, they were going over blue whales and humpback whales also. And the little girls piped up and said, well, you know, Jonah was swallowed by a whale. And the fifth grade teacher said, oh, no, darling, no. A whale can't swallow a person because their esophagus, their throat is too small. They just eat plankton and krill. And she said, no, Jonah was swallowed by a whale. She said, no. And the little girl said, well, when I get to heaven, I will ask him how he did that. And the teacher said, oh, what if he's not in heaven? And the little girl said, well, then you can ask him. Oh, me. But we love our teachers. In our Bible verse or our God inspiration, I happen to think back. Do you remember National Lampoon's Vacation? You remember Chevy Chase? I think he was Clark Griswold and his wife Ellen Griswold, and then, of course, there was Audrey and Rusty, and oh, you can't forget Aunt Edna. And what about Eddie, cousin Eddie? Oh man, yeah, I remember that. Well, it reminded me like we're all on a vacation, you know, and. Almost brought me back to, I remember being a little child, and we took a family vacation, went down to Florida, and we all piled into I think it was a Pontiac, and we were going down the road, and I think we were somewhere, I don't know exactly where we were, oh, let's say in Clearwater, Florida, or someplace, and it was getting late. I remember Mother going, well, we need to stop someplace and get a night, you know, so we can rest for the night. And I remember us children in the back going, oh, let's get a pool. I remember Holiday Inn had pools everywhere. Let's get a pool, because we didn't have pools around here. And, of course, I think my father just kept driving, and it got darker and darker, until finally we ran out of places to stay, and it was just an old, run-down place on the right-hand side of the road, and I remember we stopped, and I remember my mother walking in the room as the door was open. She just went, oh, me. It probably had green shag carpeting or something. And you know, when you think about vacations, you think about even today, we're on a vacation, aren't we? Sort of. Can life be a vacation? I mean, we're on a journey together. We have a lot of excitement and joys and unexpected expenses and bittersweet memories. I mean, we're on a vacation together. But you know, like any good family, there's got to be some rules. Here's the primary one that Jesus has given us, Matthew 7:12. do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If we would just do that, if we would just do that with each other on our journey in this vacation time, we would be fine. We would obviously get to Wally World that way too. Now, if you'll recite with me on the TV screen, it's our statement of being. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am the individualized expression of God, and am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. You okay?
Well, you know that motel he was talking about? I was there at that one. Yes, I was. I remember the green shag carpet and everything. All right. We're so glad to be here today.
And as we think about being that one, we also know that as we love, we're also yet learning to love even better, and that's what this is about. Teach me to love, show me how to care for others, cause my soul to burn within for the fellowship with others. Only you can break the chains that have held me for so long. Lord, you're my hope, my only hope.
There's no power but the power of God's love that can melt my heart and heart and show me all the pride and arrogance that tear our souls apart. For injustice that is suffered, but when I turn my head away, I humbly ask for your forgiveness. We need to learn to love again. Lord, teach me to love. Show me how to care for others. Cause my soul to burn within for the fellowship of others. Only you can break the chains that have held me for so long. Oh, you're my hope, my only hope. Teach me to love. Teach me to love, show me how to care for
Song for what we're going to do now. Let's all go within. Let's go within prayer. Father, teach me to love. Thank you for demonstrating that to us, Father, even through the voice of music. As we relax, release. Oh, remember I talked about those cares and troubles? Let's turn those over. That was yesterday. God, to my mind, I have some names I want to mention that need our prayers. Our friend, Bob Dieter. Jane. Sylvia. Lee, perhaps Rachel. I'm sure you have a name or two on your lips, a son or a daughter. Father, we ask that we don't know the conditions, we don't know the outcomes. What we do pray for, Father, is that they feel your presence in this, their experience. Teach us all to love, Father. More deep. Towards each other. Forgiving each other for what we might consider rudeness or an oversight, or it's just being human. Father, in this next 90 seconds, I would invite everyone to go within deeper and to share with God what's on your heart now, beginning now. you felt God's love even deeper. Well, Linda Kramer once said, the angel of supply is ever at hand. And so it is. Amen. Now, if you would, it's become our practice to say the Lord's Prayer, the Nora edition. It's on the TV screen. Please recite with me. Our Father, who is everywhere, your name is sacred, your kingdom is come, your will is throughout the earth, even as it is throughout the universe. You give us our needful bread from day to day, and you forgive us our offenses, even as we forgive our offenders. And you let us not enter into materialism, but you separate us from error, because yours are the kingdom, the power, the song, and praise, from all ages, throughout all ages, sealed in faith, trust, and truth. Amen. Well, I had in mind how I wanted to start it this time, and then about, 8:45 this morning, I said, nope, I'm going to change it. I wish I wouldn't do that to myself. But I was praying about it, and I just said, well, Doug, you have to change it. And I wish I wouldn't do that to myself. You know, I first mentioned some time ago that it's the fall of the year, isn't it? And when I thought of that, I thought, harvest. It's harvest time. Harvest time. You know, up in Nelson County, there's an apple orchard called Dickey Brothers Orchards. It's 100 acres, and they raise 16 different varieties of orchards, of apples. And they have to hand pick each one and put it tenderly into a basket or a buggy so that it won't get bruised and cut up or whatever, so that it would not be marketable. Harvest, harvest, I thought of that. In John 4:35, we're going to get to this, but John 4:35, Jesus said, this is an ancient saying, it's an old saying. He said, you have a saying, it's 4 months till harvest. That made me think, harvest. How many in here are farmers? Then you know this. I'm not talking about just planting some cucumbers in the backyard either. No, I'm talking about farming. No. Okay. Gotcha. You know, we think of farming, we think of harvest, we go, well, all we do is we till the soil, we sow the seed, and then irrigate, or hopefully rain, and then we pray, we cry for the crop, and then we reap. But that's not it. She can tell us, that's not it. You've got to harvest your crop. That's the hard part. That's the 12 to 14 hours a day, the harvest. I want to give us some context, because of context, we can get some clarity. In the old, I'm talking about old church. You know how today we go, let's go to church on Sunday. Well, they didn't have a church to go to. They were the church. And wherever they went, they would meet at different people's homes. Wherever they met, they took the church with them. That's the context. We've got to get some context so we get some clarity on harvest. I remember I was involved in some livestock or horses for like 25 or 30 years. And I can give you, I don't know that anything about harvesting crops, but I do know about this. I do know about waking up like in the 70s or the 80s or 90s, and on Christmas morning, and there'd be a foot and a half of snow out, and you've got to go out and feed the animals, and it's 10 or 12 degrees, and you're trudging down to the barn, and you've got to throw down 5 or 6 bales of hay. You've got to give each of them some grain, a scoop of grain. You've got to make sure everybody's got water, and everybody else is at home in Christmas opening presents and drinking coffee, having fun with each other, and you're freezing down at the barn. And I remember July 4th, everyone's running to the lake. Oh, July 4th, shoot the fireworks off. But you got to be home by 5:30 or 6 at least to get down those same 5 or 6 bales of hay, the same scoop of grain, out in the heat and sweating. I know what that's like. Let's get some context to the harvest to give us some clarity. I remember some years back, this will help you too. This might be something you can relate to. I remember some years back, it's 5, 6, 7 years, someone at the church was telling a little story. And they said that, well, they had to go away. I forget the reason why. It's like a Saturday. They had to go away. Maybe it was for a conference or some kind of meeting or something. They had 2 children at home. And they said, well, I'll leave the husband with the children. And they left. And when they got home, they walked in the door. And they said, the husband sort of grabbed him and said, don't you ever leave me alone like this again. That'll give you some context. Raising children, context to clarity. You know, when I was talking about the churches years ago, they didn't have a 501c3 like we do today. They were the church. Up in Montgomery County, there's a farm called Bran King Pumpkin Farm. This time of year, they get 50 to 60,000 pumpkins. And they have to cut them from the vine, each one individually, and pick each one up. You know, they weigh pretty much 20, 30 pounds sometimes. Pick each one up, put it in a buggy, because they can't bruise it or crack it or blemish it in any way, or it won't be marketable. 50 to 60,000 pumpkins right up here in Montgomery County. It's harvest time, 12 to 14 hours a day. In Nelson County, there's Willowcraft Vineyards. Well, they grow grapes on the grapes, and they harvest 7,000 pounds of grapes by hand because they can't get them squeezed. You can't make wine out in the field. It's harvest time. To give you some context about harvest, it's not easy. So we're going to talk about John 4. About what Jesus said. Oh, you have a saying, 4 months to harvest. What in the world was he talking about? It got me thinking, what was he talking about? It starts out, now he had to go to Samaria. Jesus was tired on his journey and he sat down at a well. It was about noon. He had to go to Samaria. That's what it says. No one had to go to Samaria, and especially a Jew. He went there on purpose. Jesus is going in the context from context to conflict. He had to go to Samaria. You know, sometimes when we think of Samaritans today, we think, oh, yeah. Billy's helping Aunt Ruth across the street. How nice of him. That's not what this is about. The Jews and the Samaritans hated each other. They looked at each other as if they were half-breeds. You see, the Samaritans didn't worship the Jewish laws at all. They even desecrated the church. Jews worshipped in Jerusalem. The Samaritans worshipped on Mount Gerizim. They were totally different. The Jews have the Torah, the five books of the five books of the law of Moses, and then the eight books of the prophets, and then 11 other books for a total of 24. Samaritans have a different Bible, and they say there are 2,000 differences between the Samaritan Bible and the Torah. They're different. They don't like each other. It'd be like you saying, you know, that nice boy with the KKK. Or, you know, he's not such a bad fellow, even though he's in ISIS. They hated each other. But it says Jesus had to go to Samaria. He's setting us up here, isn't he? Just like Jesus often does. He's setting us up. You know, I was reading about the Samaritans, and they're still around. In 2021, they counted them. There was 800 and some of them. They still worship in the West Bank of Tel Aviv. They dress like Muslims, and they're still to this day, amazingly, to this day, they still hate each other. Jesus had to go to Samaria. Well, what happened when he was there? He was tired. Remember, he sat down by the well. Then it says, a Samaritan woman came to draw water. Jesus said to her, will you give me a drink? And then it says in parentheses, his disciples had already gone into town for food. Jesus is meeting this woman who's had five husbands and she's living with someone right now. And they're going to start talking. And what she sees as her biggest problem in this discourse turns out to be her greatest opportunity. That happens to us a lot, doesn't it? Can you think about that? Something you might look as a big, big problem, and it turns out to be your greatest opportunity. You see, she just wants some water, and Jesus is sitting on the well, and he's asking her for some water, but he doesn't even have a bucket to get the water with. And she wants to argue with him too. She goes, you're a man, I'm a woman, we shouldn't be talking. You're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan, we should not be talking. And then Jesus launches into this discourse. Oh, if you knew the gift that I have, if you knew the water I had, you wouldn't lack for water anymore if you knew what I had. And she's arguing back and forth with him. You don't even have a bucket to get water. And then after a while of arguing back and forth, and he's talking about different types of water and feeding her soul and so forth, she realizes then that this is not about water. It's about something more serious, about something within. And she realizes that. You know, oftentimes it's not about your job in life or about your income in life. That makes a difference. It's about within. Just like this with the Samaritan woman. Let's read just a little bit more. And he's going back and forth with her about the water. And she finally says, well, I'm going back and to tell everyone who you really are. And he says, before you go, you know, I know who you are. You've had five husbands, and you're living with someone now, and it stops her dead in her tracks. She says, you must be a prophet. You must be the Messiah. I'm going to go back and tell the village, Sirica. I'm going to tell them all about you. So she runs to tell everyone. And I can see when she comes into the town, I can almost see her telling everyone, I met a man. And they probably, oh yeah, another one? You met a man? I met a man. I met a man. He told me everything about myself. Well, he really didn't, did he? All he did was say, you've been married 5 times and you're shacking up with Ronnie. I met a man. And then she says this. Are you the Messiah? Often we have questions, don't we? I mean, you can be you can come to church for 20, 30 years and still have questions. Is this the Messiah? You can be a pastor, a preacher, a priest, and still have questions. It's okay. It's all right. Is this the Messiah? She was confused now. She thought she knew everything. But one way, I want you to know, even in her confusion, there's a lesson here for us, because you do not get clarity until you have confusion. I know someone who's starting a new adventure in life. And of course, they want to know everything they can right now. They want to get to that end point right now. But you do not do that. You start with confusion in everything you do. Nancy remarked a few weeks ago when she was speaking, she said something about the Him and Fox program, the 7-day challenge. She said, don't be surprised when you start. If things don't get a little hectic, skeptic there for you a little bit. Confusion. In anything you start, there will be confusion. Or even in that next job, or that next relationship, or the next to-do list, or the next compliment even. I was trying to prepare myself, and I wanted to get this message of the harvest across that I had in my heart, and I wanted to share it with you. And I wanted to do it in a way that made sense. And I awakened out of bed, or I woke out of bed at like 3:50 in the morning on a Tuesday, not this past week, but the week before. I was like, how do I get this across? How do I make people hear the message? And then I realized at 3:50 in the morning, I said, I am the end of the last expression of God. And I am ever want this perfect life of acceptance and perfect love. There is no confusion in that. There is no confusion. Well, the Bible is kind of a funny thing sometimes. I have to share this with you because it made me laugh a little bit. As the disciples were coming back, they came back. Remember, they were eating. They had to take care of themselves. And they came back and they saw Jesus. They said, Rabbi, don't you want something to eat? But he said to them, I'll have food enough. I don't want your food. You know, I don't want that. I'm talking stuff now. I'm talking God stuff now. I don't need your food. And his disciples, listen to this. I don't think it was Peter that said this, but Peter would. He said, could someone have brought you some food? Right here it says it. John 4:33. Could someone have brought him some food? Did they sneak him a protein bar? I mean, how come he's not hungry? Then we get to this. John 4:35. Jesus looks at him and says, that old proverb, don't you have a saying? It's 4 months till harvest. She had run to the village, brought everyone back with her, because they were expecting and they were waiting for the Messiah to come. And this might be the man. And as they came running, please visualize with me, because I have in my mind what it would look like. They were all wearing, as you know, what they wore at the time were tunics, men and women. And oftentimes they wore a scarf around their necks or over their heads. If you can visualize this, the different colors of the whole town emptying out, coming towards him at the well. And I can almost picture it as if it was a field of wheat coming for Jesus. And he's going, here's the harvest. Here's why I came through Samaria. And he stayed. And he taught for 2 days. Beloved, those that are on the internet, those that are here, this is our harvest time. An avalanche of blessings is coming our way. It's your harvest. Life loves me and is good to me. I deserve the best it has to offer. It's your harvest. It's your harvest. I give thanks for miracles. It's your harvest. I glorify God. God glorifies me. The cycle is endless, wondrous, beautiful. It's your harvest. It's your harvest time. Please go within. God, I hope the message was delivered that it is our harvest time. All we need to do is open our hearts and accept the love that you have for us. Thank you, Father, for this day that we share together and for the days to come. Amen.
The harvest is an amazing thing. You know, I have a sister who lives on a farm, and she has what she calls a little garden. It's about 8 times the size of this church, and that's her garden on the farm. Now, for a little touch of reference, my sister is 72 years old. Her husband is 80. And she is someone who has had cancer like 4 times. And she is very tall, but looks very frail. She gets up at 4:30 in the morning, gets out there and does whatever needs doing in the garden during whatever season it is. But if you could see the joy on her face when she brings those vegetables in, and you go down to their basement, and they're just mounded up. It's amazing. Mm-hmm. And 1 year they had so many tomatoes, she couldn't can them all. She couldn't give them all away. We put them in my van, and everywhere we stopped on the way home, we'd stop at a gas station. Who needs tomatoes? Mm-hmm. On the way home, we would open up the van in the neighborhood, mm-hmm. and just yell, free tomatoes. And it was kind of like the creeper van with the candy, but we were the creeper van with the tomatoes. But if you could see the joy on her face, and I have almost never understood it because it's so much work. But oh my gosh, the joy she gets from that. I mean, there's a little joy in the harvest.
Yeah, when I was small,
We had a huge farm. I mean, I can't remember how many acres, but we had everything. We had corn, we had tobacco, the family worked. When you were of age, you worked, 9, 10 years old, I was out there doing things in the crop. But anyway, when we would go to church, people were, maybe a little tired from working in the harvest or whatever, but they sang joyously. They loved their life. They came in and just, loved being together. So I hope we can learn a lesson by that. And
the timing of this song is perfect. It's called Fields of Mercy.
Shadow.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, we call it the blessings of the gifts, but I'm going to call it the blessings of the harvest. Seems to be our theme today. Please recite with me. Today, I acknowledge God, omnipresent, as a source of all good, as a source of my good. This acknowledgement, I accept God's will, which is abundance in every aspect of my life. I release all thoughts of lack and limitation, and I am open and receptive to the increased flow of abundance to me right now. I joyfully accept the gifts of life and give freely of the special gift that I am. Through me, God omnipresent, blesses and multiplies this gift for all. Thank you, dear God.
Morning. 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 Yeah. I wouldn't knock it over either. Okay. Thank you for that beautiful music, as always. We just enjoy always having you all here to sing. And at the service also next, coming up right soon here. So, the people that bought the spaghetti dinner, it will be here Tuesday night. They're delivered at 5:30. So it'll be here at 5:30. They're usually pretty prompt, and they have been in the past. So, and if you have not paid me, please do so I can give the money to Laurel so she can put it back in the bank. So it will be here at 5:30. We should have plenty to eat. So anyhow, we've talked to MCC, and I'm going to talk to the Roanoke Physical Church about sharing a Thanksgiving service, and we will know more hopefully at the end of today if they all want to do that. So I'll have some more information about that next week. Also, in the past, our friends at MCC, when they were at their church, they had they did baskets or boxes for Christmas and Thanksgiving for people that were in need. So because they don't have a food pantry, we have talked with them, and they are going to collect money. And I think, if I understood Jeffrey right, going to do gift cards. They already have, I think, some people, some families in mind. But also, if you all know anybody that is in need, let us know. We're going to collect, I think we'll collect for November for Thanksgiving, and then we'll start for Christmas. So we'll give money for that to help. So there'll be a whole church, three churches, so we should be able to get a lot of money for needy families. So again, if you all know anybody that is in need, let us know, and we'll be glad to add that to their list. Did y'all want to say anything about that?
Absolutely.
Okay, all right, good. We still need some people to sign up on the flower calendar, so if you want to do that, please give Nancy the money in advance if possible, and she will take care of that. Let's see, other than that, we're still collecting money for the floor. It cost us like, I think, $7,500, and we collected a little over $2,000, so we're still collecting money for that. So any donations you want to give, and we're still collecting change, so if you've got change and you want to throw it in a box or something, and I'll give it to Laurel, we very appreciate it. Marie, did you have anything? Okay. Nancy, do you have anything? All right. Sure. Thank you, Doug, for that message, because we do need to be reminded. Thank you.
I want to join you down here. We've been ending our services with the prayer of protection for Ukraine and the peacekeepers and Doctors Without Borders and so forth. And here are just a few of the holy areas, I guess you could say, in the world. I know there are others also. But let's read the prayer of protection and say it together, if you would.
The light of God surrounds you. The love of God enfolds you. The power of God protects you. The presence of God watches over you. The mind of God guides you. The power of God abides in you. The strength of God renews you. Wherever you are, God is, and all is well.
Yes. Now we will close our service instead of a benediction, we'll take 90 seconds and just pray for our country in your own way, your own fashion, in your own voice. Please, starting now. Those on the internet, thank you for joining us. For you who are here in the congregation, thank you for helping us celebrate. Well, we celebrate this day of harvest together. Thank you. Amen.